By 2026, 60% of organizations will actively monitor data quality as a key component of their data governance programs, up from 20% in 2022. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research. I'm joined today by Amy, and we're here to talk about the rise of data quality as part of data governance. Amy, how you doing?
Hey, Paul. Doing great. Thanks for having me.
Awesome. So what do you do?
Yeah, I oversee growth for Anomalo. So growth includes business development, partnerships, and marketing.
Very good. Great to have you here. This is a very important topic. As you know, we have many conversations about the impacts of organizations with data quality as it comes down to the past, present, and future of applications and modernization efforts. Amy, I'd like to talk a little bit about the growing importance of data governance to leaders and enterprises as they're looking at like moving data and make it more freely available. What are your thoughts and what are you seeing in the business, in the organization?
Yeah, oh boy, such a good question, Paul. I'm glad we're discussing this, right? I think data governance is a term it's been around for a while, but it's certainly having its heyday, and your question is super relevant. First, a bit about Anomalo. So Anomalo, we're an enterprise data quality monitoring company. And the reason I bring that up is because we work with some of the most modern enterprises today, folks like Discover Financial, Block, Nationwide, Atlassian. And we work directly with their data governance leaders on the topic you just addressed. So why? You know, why do I think that's happening to answer your question? You know, I think when I think about data governance, and bear with me here on this one, Paul, it's historically always been about helping enterprise to find, understand, and trust their data, right? People built out data governance practices. They hired data governance leaders to do that. That is still happening, right? It's still about finding, understanding, and trusting, which you and I should unpack. But now there's been this big shift towards democratization as well. And I think this is really why data governance is having a moment right now, because with self-serve analytics and AI adoption, it's really increasing the pressure for these leaders that I reference to democratize data, right? Make data quality a foundational requirement to helping any business activate upon that data within their organization.
Yeah, that's a very fair point. When we look at the access to this information and we look at it in the context of applications and growth, there's a huge challenge here because you have the bridging the gap between the heritage applications, new applications, and then, of course, data quality that is an incredibly important part of the lifeline of the business, right? I hate to almost use the analogy that data is the oil of the business, but it keeps the business running, right?
It's still a good analogy to use, Paul. It's still a good analogy to use.
I'm glad to hear you say that. I love that analogy because it really does kind of drive that, that information. Like when we're thinking about how operationally businesses work, we're not in a siloed environment either, right? I mean, there's applications that are crossing not just old and new, but also geographic boundaries. And you run into things like GDPR issues and data sovereignty issues and as well as quality issues. So what are the areas there that your customers are thinking about?
Oh boy, yeah. I mean, I think when I think about applications, I broadly think about how does the enterprise want to use that data, right? And this is around activation of data. There's tons of terms that come into play there. You know, data products is certainly one that's having a heyday right now. But at the end of the day, right, what the role of data governance, and to get back to your question here, it really is about, to your point, building out applications and use cases for that data. And you mentioned things like GDPR, right? Those are necessary steps as far as making sure your data is fit for purpose, right? That's really what we're talking about. We're talking about governance when we're talking about quality, right? Is my data fit for purpose for X? And X for our customers traditionally has always been analytics, so decision-making within an enterprise, and then data science. And that's a broad catch-all, right? But think machine learning or traditional AI, big retailers that are using data in real time to personalize, let's say, a website experience for you, content recommendation engines for you. That's lightweight stuff, all the way through financial services or insurance organizations crafting real-time offers based on credit score data, right? That's all data science and machine learning obviously now there's obviously this shift towards generative AI adoption too, which is certainly changing the game and rising the importance of data quality. But to answer your direct question, it really has always been around activation of data for decision making or end product or customer experiences.
Yeah, and you know, when I think about the systems that you were talking about, you know, I tie back to one of my predictions that I was making for 2025. I was saying that, like, you mentioned AI, and of course that's an explosion of data, right? That's happening there. And, yeah. And you know, a lot of organizations are trying to do is they're really trying to scale, right? They're trying to and use AI augmented development initiatives to scale. But like one of the things I was predicting was organizations are attempting to use AI to replace the developers. You know, 50% of organizations will try to, and then they're going to try to do something, but they're going to fail. They're still going to need a human in the loop. And I think that's equally important when it comes to data quality checking. You know, and when you look at data quality and you're talking about these systems that are, you know, old and new systems connecting together, you have to have the ability to make sure that you're not sharing the wrong information for these applications as you're making these connectors happen. What are some of the key areas of success that would allow organizations to move forward without running into these challenges?
Yeah, I mean, I think this goes back to the broader topic of governance, right? If you think about governance as a way of, again, making sure data is fit for purpose, it goes into what you just described, right? Can this data be used safely within an AI use case, whether that's internal or customer facing, to your point? Something that is the most obvious use case for most people to wrap their head around is PII, right? So if I am a large enterprise that I sit on a wealth of data, maybe that's structured, maybe it's unstructured data, is there PII within those documents? That's something I need to know. It doesn't necessarily mean I can't use it, but I have to think about it in a different way, in a different regulatory fashion, or I want to remove that perhaps from feeding into, you know, any RAG pipeline as an example. So lots to unpack there. But I also want to go back to your one point about a human in the loop, Paul, because I think that's really important when you think about data quality. If you don't mind, I think it's an important thing for your listeners to understand, is that, look, there's a lot of use cases as it pertains to how AI is going to make it easier to make your data fit for purpose. We've always been big believers that you should automate the data quality detection side, right? So detecting data quality issues, but still allow a human to be the person to say, does that problem matter? Or does that anomaly change if and how I want to use this data, right? It still requires someone that has deep or at least surface level knowledge about that data asset to know if that data quality issue matters or not. And in our world, that's where we think of the human in the loop for data quality. Certainly, we use AI inside of our product, again, to automate, make it easy for the detection and discovery of data quality issues, though.
Yeah, we're seeing in research that, you know, developer time is focused on increasing levels of productivity. What we're seeing is only 24% of developers are spending their time actually writing code, right? So but they're spending their time looking at ancillary tasks like understanding the data, understanding what's happening, so they can use this information appropriately without sharing that PII data, for example. So without having these tools and these systems in place in order to, you know, call it scrub the data before it goes into the next generation of application, it's also being used you know, appropriately, so it allows for an increase in developer productivity, which I think is important. The other thing I think is equally important is we're seeing a rise in low-code and no-code solutions. To your earlier point, Amy, you were talking about the data scientists and the business analysts kind of writing their own applications. Actually, what we're seeing is in our research that in the next 24 months, what we're seeing is low-code and no-code platforms are going to grow by 30% to allow for the, quote, citizen developer to develop their own applications and let their professional developer focus on more innovative tasks. That's an important thing. But when you're hiring, another stat that I'll share, when you're hiring 67% of organizations are looking to hire generalists over specialists. If you're hiring generalists to do the job, are they aware of what they can and cannot share when it comes to the data? And that is a key factor when it comes to these applications. So Could you tell a little bit about, talk a little bit about the ecosystem there and what the ecosystem means and what the impacts are around that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think there's, again, a lot to unpack. I love your questions. To answer your direct question, then I do want to come back to developer productivity. I do think when I think of the ecosystem, right? So my role, again, business development and partnerships, we always think about what we do with data quality as a part of a broader ecosystem, right? So our customers, Discover, Nationwide, folks I mentioned earlier, they're not leveraging Anomalo in a silo, right? But they're leveraging Anomalo on the back of their data warehouse or data lake. Think Snowflake, Databricks, BigQuery. They might be using us in conjunction with a data catalog, which we should unpack, which is a big part of a data governance strategy today. So when I think about what is the ecosystem doing for developer productivity, I think Databricks is probably one of the best examples of this, right? They've always been a more modern developer-focused platform, but now they're realizing they also have to meet the business user where they are, right? So they've obviously come out with SQL Warehouse. They have AI BI, right, to actually apply some of the things you're talking about today to the analytics world. They've developed Unity Catalog, which is a modern data catalog that we integrate and work with. So there's a lot there, but I think the ecosystem is realizing that, okay, we have to actually service everyone in the data team, right, from the data engineering side through the data platform leader to the business team. And that's a shift, right? There used to be the technologies that service the data engineer, and then the technologies that service the analyst, the business user. Now we're seeing people try to appeal and build tools to facilitate the entire stack, which obviously, you know, AI and a lot that you've talked about has obviously facilitated that growth.
Yeah, but there's also a lot of challenges with like build versus buy type of approaches, right? I mean, if you're going to build something yourself, the devils are in the details, right? You may want to flex your technical strength and your bench strength to say, hey, we can do this. But once you build it, you own it, right? And if you own it, you better know all the pieces that go along with it, right? And compliance, governance, and regulations are changing all the time. So what are your thoughts there?
Yeah, it's a fantastic question. I mean, I think it comes back to what's the use case of the thing you're building, right? So let's get more specific, I think, in this world of data products. And I gave the example earlier about, you know, to when you expose a data quality issue, a human in the loop must have some foundational knowledge of how that data is used. I actually think that in the past, we've unfairly asked too much of, you know, data engineers. I use data engineers as a catch-all, right? But these data teams who are actually getting data into a data warehouse, scrubbing for data quality, responsible for observability, right? Everything there, to your point, they've built out these systems for governance. They've built out these systems for cataloging data, for building rules on top of that data. But they're really challenged because sure, they might own that system, but they don't actually know how that data is being used. And this is a big shift, right? This is a big shift that data should no longer just be an IT concern, because those folks that are in that IT space, that data engineering space, it's a lot to ask them to understand exactly how this data is being used for machine learning, for generative AI, for analytics, right? So I think going back to your point on no code, low code UIs, this is huge, right? Because now we're giving the business user the ability to take more ownership of the things that they are going to activate upon the data for. And this is big. This is big to me, where I actually think it's going to be great to say, data engineer, you own getting the data fit for purpose or getting it into a data warehouse. But data analyst, you actually own making sure that you have confidence that that data is ready to be used in the context that you want to use it for.
Yeah, you use the word ownership. And what I like about that word, I also want to add the word accountability, because you know, that's a big factor. If you're building access to information, you know, the fact that IT has access to data, a lot of times IT is saying, okay, well, we're going to just provide you, you know, the lines of business access to the information, but the governance, compliance and regulations needs to be taken into consideration. The business and the user of that information is still accountable for that information. So whatever goes out the door, they're still accountable, whether you use an AI or whatever. I was right. Talking to somebody recently and they're like, oh, well, you know, we pushed some code out the door and the AI engine built it. It was all wrong. It's like, but that was a tool. that wasn't, right. You know, it wasn't, the AI is an employee of yours, it's a tool.
It's a means to an end, yeah.
Right, it's a means to an end, exactly. So, but no, Amy, this is great. We are like touching the tip of the iceberg on a lot of this stuff here. Where would you recommend the audience and the viewers go if they wanted to find out more information about this?
Yeah, there's a lot. And you're right, we're just scratching the surface, right? On, you know, accountability is a part of governance, data quality is a part of governance, right? All of these things that you're talking about here. We put out a good amount of content on the Anomalo blog recently, and it's not just our point of view, but it's the point of view of our customers, right? You see leaders from ADP, Nationwide, Labara, all these data governance leaders talking about how they're democratizing access to data. Now, we actually recently put out something we're calling the Data Governance Visionaries series. So it features these customers as well as thought leaders like the Google Cloud governance practice lead, talking about some of the themes that he's seeing from his customer base as well in the modern times of data and data governance. So feel free to check it out or get in touch with myself on LinkedIn.
Amy, it's always a pleasure talking to you. This is great. And I know the audience is kind of giving them something to think about here. There's a lot of insights and advice that you can provide has been really, really powerful on this session here today. I want to thank you for your time. I want to thank the audience for watching. This is just a small subset of what we're covering. It gives you a little bit to think about when you're looking at your efforts and your modernization initiatives that you're looking at here for data and data quality. But thank you for your time and have a great day.
Yeah, thanks, Paul.